Sometimes I get to feeling I was back in the old days, long ago, when we were kids, when we were young. Things seemed so perfect, you know. The days were endless, we were crazy, we were young. The sun was always shining, we just lived for fun. Sometimes it seems like lately, I just don't know. Rest of my life's been just a show. Those were the days of our lives. The bad things in life were so few.
So fleet the works of men back to their earth again, and ancient and holy things fade like a dream. But it is up in cloudland, unseen from the earth, where we find castles in the air. The foot of mankind has never trod their towers, but here, beyond the veil, inspiration is found. Meanwhile on earth, stately castles whose turrets once pierced the sky have left an imperishable record. Though the storms of centuries have laid waste to the works of men, their spirit soars on, and poets make live again the days of chivalry and honorable behavior. Our story takes place in medieval England, in the Age of Faith. Her chronicles tell of warriors and statesmen, of royal crusaders, and of jousting knights. Her ballads sing of jolly friars, of troubadours, and of gallant outlaws who roamed her mighty forests. History, in its ideal state, is a compound of legend and chronicle, and from out of both, we offer you an impression of the Middle Ages. Excitement rises high for the final event in a tournament. From far and near have come all of England's knighthood, for on the morrow they depart on the Holy Crusade. And so, the lofty battlements of the castle look down upon the chivalry of England in all its glory. Richard of the Lion Heart, England's immortal king, will oversee the tournament. He is impulsive, generous, and brave. Next to him is Prince John, the king's brother. He is sinister and dour, his heart inflamed with an unholy desire to succeed to Richard's throne. High above the clash of lance and shield, in joust and tourney, the fairest maiden was chosen to reign for a day as the queen of love and beauty. Meet Lady Marian Fitzwalter, from whose slim white hands would fall the chaplet of valor on the victorious knight. Next, we see Sir Guy of Gisborne, intimate of Prince John, and one of the two contenders for the championship.
Your veil for a favor, fair lady, that you may see it worn in victory.
The other contender for the championship is the favorite of King Richard, the Earl of Huntingdon. And here we have the Earl of Huntingdon's trusted squire. His loyalty is never in question, but he isn't beyond putting something itchy in his master's helmet for a laugh.
In the early days, a tournament was a miniature war played for sport. The tournament field stretched over miles and could include villages and towns. It was terribly popular.
Let the games begin.
To gain an unfair advantage, Gisborne straps himself to his saddle.
Brother, I'll wager you this livery collar against your prize falcon that Huntingdon wins the day.
I bet on the knight with the white plume.
The marshals inspect the equipment of the contestants.
Why did medieval knights feel they needed to stick swans and trees on their helmets and their shields? Why indeed have banners?
The thing is, nowadays we recognize famous people by their faces because we've seen photos of them countless times in the media. But back in the Middle Ages, you'd have no idea what anyone looked like unless you'd actually met them face to face. And that's why people had coats of arms.
So you'd know who it was.
They splinter their lances, ever a good omen for Huntingdon.
I double my bet on Huntingdon.
What made the Norman knights different was the fact they fought on horseback. And since the French for horse was cheval, a mounted warrior was known as a chevalier. And so the code of conduct for knights, indeed their whole culture, became known as chivalry. How could you control these men? How could you channel their testosterone culture into something that was less destructive of society? The idea society came up with
was to try and invent a code of behavior by which the knightly class must learn to govern themselves.
The king is delighted. He has won the wager with his brother. The best man has won. But it is unlikely Prince John will have the strength of character to hide his hurt at losing his beloved falcon, and an endless cycle of resentment and retaliation perpetuates in his heart.
Huntingdon has proved his knightly mettle. We hereby decree that on this holy crusade, he shall be our second in command. Go to the fair maid, Marian, and receive the victor's crown.
Exempt me, sire. I am afeard of women.
We all need a time to laugh. It's up to us to slip on a banana peel, or to bonk ourselves on the head. Laughter is the sun that drives winter from the human face and makes our aura sparkle, attracting unseen, positive forces, like bees to honey. But remember, the bee collects honey from flowers in such a way as to do the least damage or destruction to them. The bee leaves the flowers whole, undamaged, and fresh, just as he found them. In the same way, the influence of unseen positive forces on our lives can be as gentle as dandelion seeds floating in the air. Peals of laughter ring out from the king, at the sight of a great warrior running for freedom, away from the battlefield. Freedom is what you do with what is being done to you. Freedom is oxygen to the soul, but our hero's instinct was to seek security. The trusted squire adds fuel to the fire.
Oh no, yet another woman.
In the great hall of the castle, the feasting that followed close upon the tournament has lasted far into the dawn. Brave hearts smile through parting tears. knightly lovers tell again their love to maidens fair. Ladies' eyes speak courage to their knights. Sitting apart from the others, Prince John and Sir Guy of Gisborne plot. They are dizzy with wine and drunk with thoughts of power. The king's goblet is carried by a page boy. The goblet had first been presented to the king to commemorate his bravery and heroic feats in battle. Many of these would be largely forgotten if it were not for this goblet and the tales told each time the king drank from its deep depths. Made of gold, every part of every surface is richly decorated except the narrow strip where the king's lips would touch the rim. But Prince John would not find refreshment from the goblet, merely more poison for his jealousies.
Dog of a servant, this on the morrow shall be mine, and everything else that is the king's shall then also be mine.
A servant hath a friend, and his friend hath a friend. Be discreet, my prince.
Where is Huntingdon?
With dagger held at his head, he doth try his strength for the champion's goblet.
At such a time as this, it were more befitting that he try his love for a maid.
The motto of chivalry, to serve all for the betterment of mankind, is also the motto of wisdom. The king's jester had wisdom. He was wise enough to play the fool while having much influence on the king. A wise man knows himself to be a fool, while a fool thinks himself to be wise. The king was a wise man, but power has no blessing except when it is used to protect the innocent.
Everywhere the ceremony of innocence is drowned, the falcon cannot hear the falconer. Things fall apart, the best lack all conviction, while the worst are full of passionate intensity. But now I know, a shape with lion body and the head of a man is moving its size, and the darkness drops.
Why hast thou not a maid?
When I return, my good liege.
Nay, before you go, my good knight.
Thank you.
a castle and lands to the maid who wins him.
You two shall have your pick of maidens, my Gisborne. So, sits the wind in that direction, the Lady Marian, a goodly choice.
The trusted squire, like his master, lives by his values and ethics. As our hero rushes to do what he considers to be the right thing, the squire leaps to his support. Being ethical means knowing and having the courage to do what is right. Action is the sole medium of expression for ethics.
Forget, Sir Knight, I am a prince. It is only the prince that has forgotten who he is.
Ethics determine choices and actions, and suggest difficult priorities. Prince John tries to take the easy way out, and wipe his hands clean of his unchivalrous behavior. Some say, the age of chivalry is gone, but the age of chivalry will never be passed, so long as there is a wrong left continuing on earth.
I regret, Lady Marian, that a brother of our noble king should so degrade his knighthood.
I fear you have incurred his enmity on my behalf.
It was but my knightly privilege. Interference is a dangerous pastime, my squire.
Between stimulus and response, there is a space. In that space is our power to choose our response. In our response lies our growth and our freedom. Freedom has many dimensions, but true freedom cannot be altered by the interference of an outsider. The freedom comes from within. Love expands such liberty so it reaches out and connects with another. True love raises and supports the other so that both can know freedom. It can take a while to become accustomed to new emotions. Should we take the safe option, which is to resist and ignore the feelings? Or should we tentatively dip our toe in the water? Or do we throw ourselves in with unbridled abandon?
I never knew a maid could be like you.
Time is too slow for those that wait, too swift for those who fear, too long for those who grieve, too short for those who rejoice. But for those who love, time is eternity. In its immature state, love says, I love you because I need you. Whereas, in its mature state, love says, I need you because I love you. Let us always meet each other with a smile, for the smile is the beginning of love. Now, all too swiftly, comes the hour of parting. Over the kneeling hosts, the bishop lifts his hand in benediction. And for the cross that gleams upon his shoulder, each knight breathes a silent vow. Meanwhile, on the castle battlements, love's young dream blossoms.
Would you grant an English knight your favor?
Our hero is afraid he will be rejected.
Huntingdon!
My lord king, I go to the Holy Land with half a heart, the other half I leave in the keeping of a maid.
Good, now your blade will be keener.
I leave in your keeping, my dearest treasure. Guard her with your life. See that Richard never returns from the Holy Land, nor Huntingdon.
Even kings must wait on love, as our hero cannot bear to be separated from his new devotion. The word goodbye stems from saying God be with you. Our yesterdays and history never really say goodbye. They say see you later.
Huntingdon's head for Lady Marian's hand. Do not forget, you have promised me this.
Led by the king, with our hero at his side, the long road out of the castle gates rejoiced all day with clanking steel and prancing horses. Lining the roadside were rustling silks and velvets, and cheers of good luck and support. And so, the very flower of England's knighthood marched on to its high purpose. Scarce had the dust of the Crusaders settled to the ground when the dire mischief of Prince John was set afoot.
When the throne is mine, I will reward those who serve me to your task and spare no one. Thank you.
of England fell under the paw of Prince John's perfidy, his faithlessness and treachery against his brother. By Prince John's orders, the good officials of the town of Nottingham are ousted.
I am now the High Sheriff of Nottingham.
The poor who cannot pay the tax levy are forced to give up their belongings. For slaying a wild boar in Prince John's forest, the king's subjects are punished. For spurning Prince John's speeches and addresses, the king's subjects are punished. In Richard's castle, Prince John's henchmen apprise him of their evil successes.
Your bidding has been done. Huntingdon's castle is razed and burnt to the ground.
Lady Marian watches on as Prince John toasts his successes, drinking from the king's goblet.
Have mercy on the people of England.
Fret not your pretty head for such as they.
Prince, your oppressions will not please our king.
A prince at home outranks a king abroad. Think you not so, beautiful lady?
If Richard knew these things, there would be no prince at home.
Prince John calls over one of his henchmen.
That maid bears watching.
The underhand chameleon hears Prince John's words as an instruction and sets off to spy on Lady Marian. In silence and at night, Marian gets an idea.
Take this message and sleep not by night nor day until you reach your master.
Day after day, across the fields of France, the Crusaders had plodded on.
Mark how Huntingdon spurs them on. He is the very backbone of the adventure.
A good way to crack a person's head, my master, would it were thy brothers.
To your tent, these fevers are but passing ills. Before the night falls, you will be able to march again.
He plays his tricks of discipline to cozen the favor of the king, the sycophant.
But for discipline, I would twist you round a tent pole and crack your spine. Why come you here?
The people suffer and perish. The women of the castle hang their heads in shame. Intrigue and death lurk in every corner. Desperately, my heart cries out to you. England is doomed.
If the king should know of this himself, he would return, and this holy crusade would fail. If Richard had but one friend in England.
fetch a falcon.
My beloved, by some pretext, I shall persuade the king to allow me to return. On the heels of this missive, I shall be in England. Signed, Huntingdon. Speed this letter and prepare our departure. I pray you, my lord and king, to speak again of your trust in me, which you have so oft professed.
As I trust my right hand, do I trust you. You are my friend.
Then, my liege, I request your leave and favor to return to England without unfoldment of my purpose.
Like a musician doing scales to keep his fingers supple, the king thinks over the fundamentals of the request. A true friend would die for him, not desert him in battle.
I humbly beseech you, not as my king, but as my friend, to place unquestioned this trust in me.
Is not the maid? You turn chicken-hearted for a wench? You do but jest. Go join the lances of your king.
Sire, what needs doing must be done, but my heart aches that your friendship fails me.
Because of their exquisite speed and the ability to navigate to their original position, carrier pigeons were used to deliver messages between units on the front lines back to base. In case of emergency, the soldier would write a paper message in a small tube attached to the pigeon's leg and release the bird into the sky. The job of delivering messages was not easy at all. Once in the air with a message attached to their legs, carrier pigeons became a target for enemy soldiers who tried to shoot them down. Another way of disrupting carrier pigeon communications was by using hawks
and falcons.
Carrier pigeons were extremely successful in doing their jobs. However, since they were trained to fly back to their home lofts, carrier pigeons were intended to be used only for delivering messages from the front lines back to base. These hero birds did their jobs even in the harshest weather conditions, and for extremely long distances, carrying on their mission even when wounded.
My beloved, by some pretext, I shall persuade the king to allow me to return. On the heels of this missive, I shall be in England. Signed, Huntingdon. Sire, you must trust me. We wait not on permission. We go to England, though hell itself should gape and bid us stay.
A deserter.
Is this true?
The truth is that back in England, my beloved, by some pretext, I shall persuade the king to allow me to return. On the heels of this missive, I shall be in England, signed, Huntingdon.
Just as a candle cannot burn without fire, the king felt his heart plunged into an abyss. Walking with a friend in the dark is better than walking alone in the light.
Sire, the penalty is death.
Have his wound attended. Place him in that tower. He will remain a prisoner until our return. See to it that he is well cared for.
But my liege, the penalty is death.
My command, obey.
Thank you. Give them food and drink until our last column is well on its way. Then let them rot.
In England, Lady Marian's serving woman comes under the dread Inquisition of John.
Tell me, what has become of Huntingdon's squire?
I'll tell, it is true, he did carry information from my mistress to the king.
Lady Marian shall pay for this with her life. So much for meddling.
Quick, fly for your life, he means to kill.
I seek Lady Marian Fitzwalter.
Lady Marian and her serving woman flee the castle. Desperation is the raw material of drastic change. The only way to make sense of change is to plunge into it, move with it, and join the dance. You cannot change the seasons or the wind, but you can change yourself. Our circumstances inspire us in relation to what direction we want to go within ourselves.
after her, bring her back. I'll put an end to tattling and idly letting out secrets.
If we don't change, we don't grow. If we don't grow, we aren't really living. But change is not easy. If there is no struggle, there is no progress. We are like eggs. We cannot go on indefinitely as being just an ordinary, decent egg. We must be hatched or go bad.
I bring news of my Lady Marian.
Scarce was the last column of England's knighthood well on its way, when through the air there runs a thrill of coming stir.
to England with all haste. There is work to do.
Meanwhile, in England, sturdy men, rebellious to Prince John's tyranny, sought refuge in Sherwood Forest. These lusty rebels awaited a leader to weld them into a band. An outlaw band, destined to live immortal in legend and story. Such leader was soon to arrive, as a friend of King Richard returns to his native soil, but to sad news.
My good, kind, benevolent lord. Poor Lady Marian. It was on this very spot. Here. Leaving a riderless horse. An overturned saddle.
To God, to Richard, and to her.
Thus it was that Huntingdon buried his yesterday. Here began a new life. A life to be dedicated to revenge, bitter, but joyous. Other joys. In far-off Palestine, Richard meets with victory and concludes a truce with the infidel. A year passed, and then, from the mysterious depths of Sherwood Forest, came whispers of the rise of a robber chief.
Robin Hood.
The High Sheriff of Nottingham feels the long arm of the robber chief.
It is the naked arrow of Robin Hood and sings death to the enemies of King Richard.
A butcher's stall in Loxley town also receives a message from the robber chief. But this time, the arrow is not naked.
The Three Lions of Richard. It is Robin Hood's manner of saying, if you be brave, come to Sherwood Forest, Richard is your king.
the rich man of Wakefield feels the long arm of the robber chief. Like the sheriff, he receives a naked arrow, a warning to mend their ways.
He seems to be everywhere. I confess I am helpless. Our very soldiers desert to join this outlaw's band.
Fetch me a bag of gold. Lands and a bag of fine gold to the one who captures this Robin Hood, signed John. This will put a stop to it.
Thank you.
As he disappears into the forest, Robin leaps with joy. This is Will Scarlet, a prominent member of Robin Hood's Merry Men, and Friar Tuck, a jovial monk with a love of food and ale. Little John, we've met earlier, formerly Robin's squire, he remains Robin's companion, and is now second in command of the Merry Men. Robin relates to his friends how he got Prince John's bag of gold. They return to Robin Hood's lair.
Take notice of his hat.
Allan a Dale, a wandering minstrel before joining Robin's band of outlaws.
1, 2, 3.
Robin Hood, riding through the glen. Robin Hood with his band of men. Feared by the bad, loved by the good. Robin Hood, Robin Hood, Robin Hood. They handled all the trouble on the English country scene and still found plenty of time to sing. Robin Hood, Robin Hood, Robin Hood.
Meanwhile, Prince John's dark schemes are sped in distant lands. This is Richard's sleeping tent.
Thank you.
Now we head for England and my reward.
Alas, poor fool, thou hast played king once too often.
Gisborne, in his haste to claim his reward, failed to notice that it was the court jester who was sleeping in the king's bed.
Gisborne.
The king realizes the jester had been no fool. He had tried warning the king about Prince John. On the morrow, a messenger from England relates the full measure of Prince John's treachery.
Let John get his belly full.
In Sherwood Forest, a gallant outlaw, a sometime knight now known as Robin Hood, hath a band of followers and does thwart the prince at every turn.
A robber knight, eh? Methinks I know who it is. We go to England, mayhap to join this outlaw's band.
Prince John's hired soldiers levy tax payments on the Priory of St. Catherine's.
Has this prince no regard for Holy Church?
Meanwhile, nearby, Robin Hood and his merry men distribute dole to needy villagers.
Robin Hood, riding through the glen. Robin Hood, with his band of men. Feared by the bad, loved by the good. Robin Hood, Robin Hood, Robin Hood. To a tavern on the green, they vowed to help the people of the king. They handled all the trouble on the English country scene, and still found plenty of time to sing. Robin Hood, riding through the glen. Robin Hood, with his band of men. Feared by the bad, loved by the good. Robin Hood.
Two, three.
Robin Hood, Robin Hood, Robin Hood.
King John's spy sees an opportunity to get lost in the confusion. He will hide, wait, and watch to see where Robin goes.
They are of the Priory of St. Catherine's.
The Priory Garden.
It is Robin Hood and his men. Is not that the Earl of Huntingdon?
Tis Robin Hood.
Robin Hood to the poor, mayhap, but he was born Robert, Earl of Huntingdon.
Prepare thyself, within these holy walls there is someone dear to you. Lady Marian.
But scarce a day's journey away was a menace to their newfound happiness. Sir Guy of Gisborne.
'Tis the Earl of Huntingdon with Lady Marion.
The secret is out, and Prince John's spy is there to witness it.
Each day, do loyal men rally to our cause. It will not be long before we storm the very castle itself.
A 100 troopers approach.
To horse!
I'll follow!
When the lark sings in the morning, I'll send you a message to re-speak my love.
Robin Hood is the Earl of Huntingdon. And Lady Marion Fitzwalter lives.
Surround this band of outlaws with all your men, by hook or by crook, take Huntingdon alive. Seize that wench, drag her here, she shall die the death I promised.
When the lark sings in the morning, Robin sends his message of love to Marion, as he promised. The knight has brought inspiration as to how to best express his feelings.
Give her this rose and tell her,
oh, you're a beautiful rose in the morning. Oh, you're a beautiful flower in spring. I want to pick you, baby, to give you everything.
At a shrine to his lady and his king, Robin contemplates all that he holds most dear. The Sheriff of Nottingham has arrived to seize Lady Marion. Lady Marion tells the Sheriff to keep his distance. He respects her wishes, but underhand scoundrel that he is, this doesn't stop him giving the order for her to be taken away. We are all helpless, we are all heroes, it just depends on the day. But today, the nuns were unable to save Lady Marion. Unaware of this crisis, Robin practices his archery skills. Unless you enjoy life passionately and work to perfect your skills, you cannot be a good artiste. When it comes to mastering ourselves, we all need to consider ourselves works of art. Like a carpenter, we are in the process of carving a thing of beauty by chipping away parts of wood that are not needed. We are the artiste, getting all our vanities and habits out of the way, so that the inner self can be revealed. We want to be like the arrow flying through the air, leaving no trace. Ill thoughts leave a trace like a serpent. We never want to target someone with arrows dipped in fire. Robin had taught his men to believe in the words of Martin Luther King, who said, "In struggling for human dignity, the oppressed people of the world must not allow themselves to become bitter or indulge in hate campaigns. To retaliate with hate and bitterness will do nothing but intensify the hate in the world. We must have sense enough and morality enough to cut off the chain of hate. This can be done only by projecting the ethics of love to the center of our lives."
All the troops from Nottingham Town surround the forest.
"'Tis a good time to take the town." "To the trees with all our men, entrap these troops. I go to Nottingham, with Scarlet and Allan a Dale. We three shall take the town."
As more troops approach the forest's perimeter, Robin, Will Scarlet, and Allan a Dale lead them away, back to Nottingham Town.
"The horse is the most powerful weapon that a knight has. The horse is a flight animal, and its natural reaction, which is perfectly sensible, is there is a threat, so you run away. But the knight's training should bring the horse to a point where it's really an extension of the rider, that the horse's legs are moving as if they are the rider's own legs, and that when the rider asks for something, it happens instantly."
Meanwhile, in the forest, Robin Hood's men entrapped the troops who had ventured into the depths of the leafy canopy. Near the gates of Nottingham Town, the hooves of three horses fast approaching can soon be heard.
"Rouse the townspeople." "Man the walls, every mother's son of you."
"To the back door."
At the back door, Robin and Allan a Dale give the troops a mighty welcome. As the townsfolk welcome the troops with a place to put their feet up, Little John arrives at the priory.
The prince's soldiers. Lady Marian. Brutally abducted. The saints protect her.
Fly to your master.
Lady Marian is delivered to the castle. It took Lady Marian a while to detach from the chaos and mayhem she felt, and to reorient herself so that she could start making good, clear decisions based on the reality of her situation. The reality was, that Prince John now had the key to Lady Marian's physical freedom, but not to her inner self. The goal is to become so absolutely free and at peace within, that our very existence is an act of rebellion against any oppression. But none are more hopelessly enslaved than those who falsely believe they are free, as did Prince John, who thought he was free to carry on in any which way he pleased. We have to emancipate ourselves from mental slavery. To know yourself as the being underneath the thinker, the stillness underneath the mental noise, the love and joy underneath the pain, is the freedom, the salvation, the enlightenment. The timely arrival of Gisborne saves Lady Marian from Prince John, but darkness cannot drive out darkness. Gisborne had returned to claim his reward, Lady Marian.
Richard is dead. Long live King John.
Send heralds to the north and heralds to the south. England is mine.
A mysterious stranger invades Sherwood Forest.
He seeks Robin Hood.
Why seek you Robin Hood?
He says perhaps to join him, perhaps to slay him.
So ho, my pretty knight, to do either, you needs must prove your mettle first. I'll nop your scop.
Thank you.
with such strength, you almost make me think you are Richard himself.
Richard, the Lionheart! The Lion King, Richard!
It is the king! The king is!
Each member of this band has an arrow in yonder tree. Speed yours there too.
Exulting in their freedom, the people of Nottingham Town hang Prince John in effigy.
One, two, three.
Through the glen, Robin Hood with his band of men, feared by the bad, loved by the good. Robin Hood. They handled all the trouble on the English country scene, and still found plenty of time to sing. Robin Hood.
Soldiers have carried Marian away to the castle.
Damn their hides, I'll lash them till they bleat. Keep the town safe. I go to the castle, you to the forest, fetch every man, we'll make John sing a pretty song tonight.
At the castle, Gisborne decides it is time to claim his reward.
Close the drawbridge.
Thank you.
Gisborne.
My men are on their way, watch for them. If they fail, defend yourself. I surrender.
Robin Hood is taken.
Bring him here. Forty archers, make ready. We shall teach you which way to face. Bind him to yonder post. When I dip my dagger, he dies.
We have captured the outlaws. Lower the bridge.
The High Sheriff of Nottingham gets what's coming to him. Prince John's chief henchmen get what's coming to them.
Robin Hood, Robin Hood, riding through the glen. Robin Hood, Robin Hood, with his band of men. Feared by the bad, loved by the good. Robin Hood, Robin Hood, Robin Hood. To a tavern on the green, they vowed to help the people of the king. They handled all the trouble on the English country scene, and still found plenty of time to sing. Robin Hood, Robin Hood, riding through the glen. Robin Hood, Robin Hood, with his band of men. Feared by the bad, loved by the good. Robin Hood, Robin Hood, Robin Hood.
Captain Huntingdon.
Huntingdon!
Huntingdon!
Hear ye all. Until now, Richard has never bowed his head to any man. But I did mistrust my friend, and with all humility do ask forgiveness.
Tonight,
we all celebrate.
That night, everyone comes to the castle. In the courtyard, they celebrate. The bride and the groom escape the wedding revelries.
Of the Starship Enterprise. Scotty beamed us down here by mistake. Spock, you've got to get us out of here. Hi, Captain, I'd like to, but can I get a fix?
Question your life.
life is not just only about struggle. Understand that reality itself doesn't have to be harsh. It's about understanding your independence and your freedom to move in the direction you would like to move. Have a lot of aspirations and a lot of dreams. You've gone through a lot of tough lessons in the past, but rise above that burdensome energy, rise above the fray. Because of your indomitable spirit, you're able to keep going, and it's like you're becoming stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger through the process. It's a process of healing, and what you're healing may actually be the greatest gift that you can give to humanity. You want to leave like some form of legacy. Once we figured out our deepest wounds, heal that, understand it, it's also our greatest gift as well. So something that you've been through or something that you've been going through, complete the lesson of it. Gain the wisdom and the insight. Unlock life, the warmth of life, the joy of life, the grace of life. Understand the interconnectedness of everything. Understand like the divine nature and the divine reality of the universe itself. Be like the eyes of the eagle, literally. Eagles have the perception to be able to see down below and also forward and all around. Cleanse, spiritually reset, and reconnect spiritually to yourself and heal your inner world and understand the divine nature of reality. Have emotional balance and spiritual balance. Find peace and harmony within your inner world. Put the emphasis and focus on the unconscious in your inner world. Don't just rely on just pure logic anymore. It's important to follow your intuition and internal reflection, the depths of the unconscious, the depths of awareness. Learn, evolve, expand your mind. You know, it's like when we level up in our lives, our new things start to happen in our lives, and it does require us to take on more responsibility. And also too, like anytime we're really wanting to progress and wanting to become more and wanting to evolve, we have to take on a form of like more responsibility, right? Because sometimes you have to learn. Well, in order to learn, it's like you have to actually pull out your computer, actually do the research, actually learn. Or if something new comes into your life that requires more responsibility of you, it's like you actually have to hold yourself accountable. This is like your happiness, your dreams, and following your heart and trusting in yourself. The one thing to keep in mind is be patient. You know, Rome wasn't built overnight, and that's a saying that you probably hear a lot, but Rome was not built overnight, and you're gonna have to continuously use your willpower. Now, if you think about a castle, that's a big ass house, right? So, it's a big ass house, you know what I mean? So it's like, but you know, castles take time to build. And you have to start somewhere, brick by brick, laying the foundation. You're manifesting your dreams, building castles, building metaphorically, like building. You're building new dreams, building new castles in the sky. It's like that rave song, that old techno song, Castles in the Sky, by Ian Van Dyl. But it's like, as above, so below. So using your willpower, bring about the dream come true, the legacy being created, the legacy being built. Use your willpower and figure things out and then start to focus on solutions. When we think about transcendence, we're leaving space-time to transcendence energy. So it's like you're transcending the base level to the spiritual world. Understand that life is way more than just what you thought it to be. It's like you may be pulled in two different directions. It's not about only going one direction and keeping the things that you've already known. You gotta allow yourself to explore. Open your mind and broaden your intellect. Become wiser, smarter, more spiritually mature. How does one allow their mind to collect new ideas? It's about being open-minded and having to learn and evolve and grow. Get accustomed to learning newer things, but also keep the things that you've already known. It's like changing your thought process in a way, changing the way you think. And sometimes when we learn a bunch of new information, it's like, well, how much is this applicable for my life? How much of it makes sense for where I'm at right now? What works and what doesn't work? And what are my old beliefs and old thoughts that don't work anymore? And how do I need to educate myself? Or how do I need to learn to figure things out? And that's something to be aware of and something that to figure out just in general. But it's also about your inner world and how rooted you are and how connected you feel to your foundation. It's really like an inner world. You just can't give up on yourself. The universe is wanting you to keep it going, keep it pushing. It's like, you just being able to just see through the bullshit and just see the reality and the truth of everything. Find spiritual peace and harmony and balance.